Hey everyone, Noah Zerbe here. This is one of a series of short videos looking at contemporary environmental challenges in the context of global politics. This video deals with emergent tensions over the Arctic, so let's get to it. The Arctic, as shown in green here, is the region of the world above the Arctic Circle, that is, above 66 degrees 33 minutes north latitude. Most of that area is ocean, and historically it was inaccessible due to year-round sea ice. But global climate change is melting that ice, making the Arctic more accessible, and the eight countries that surround the Arctic are all making claims on access to the opportunities that are emerging. And so in this video, we're going to consider some of those issues that are emerging now as competition over the Arctic intensifies. These include questions of sovereignty and military defense, resource extraction and access to the new resources, international trade and access to and control over new shipping lanes, and global environmental questions more broadly. So let's consider each of these briefly in turn. Historically, the Arctic had an interesting position in international law. As we just observed, there are eight countries that border the Arctic: Canada, Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Norway, Russia, Sweden, and the United States. According to the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, each of these countries have territorial waters that extend 12 nautical miles into the ocean, into the Arctic Ocean. The territorial waters are subject to national or domestic law and jurisdiction in this basically the same way that land territory would be. That is, countries have sovereign control over their territorial waters. However, countries must grant what's called innocent passage through such waters to other countries' shipping. This principle is usually referred to as freedom of navigation. The law of the sea also grants each country an exclusive economic zone that extends 200 nautical miles into the sea. In this area, countries do not have sovereignty, but instead have sovereign right to the economic resources in those waters. States bordering on the Arctic historically cooperated across a number of issue areas, and that cooperation has been facilitated by, at least in recent years, the Arctic Council. Established in 1993, the Arctic Council is an intergovernmental organization with membership comprised of the eight states that border the Arctic. Only states with sovereign claims to territory inside the Arctic Circle are eligible for full membership in the Council. That said, the Arctic Council also has a number of observer states, including countries like Germany, China, the United Kingdom, India, and Japan. Acceding to observer status requires that the observer states recognize the Arctic states' sovereign rights over the Arctic. That is, they have to recognize the sovereign claims of countries like Canada, Russia, the United States, Iceland, and others. It also requires that the observer countries recognize the legal framework governing the Arctic, including the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. Indigenous communities residing in the Arctic are also eligible to participate in the Arctic Council as Indigenous permanent participants. Currently, six Arctic Indigenous communities representing about 400,000 people have permanent participation status, and these include the Alouit, the Athabaskan Arctic, the Inuit, and the Sami, among others. Historically, the Arctic Council provided an interesting example of successful international cooperation. Working across a number of issue areas, including areas like search and rescue, oil spill prevention, science and technology sharing, and so on, the Arctic Council has been a model of how a robust, rules-based regime can operate in the international system. But increasing tensions along a number of fronts appear to be weakening cooperation in the Council as new fault lines begin to emerge. Historically, the Arctic region was a region of general cooperation and low tension, but as the Arctic sea ice retreats, areas traditionally difficult to access are now increasingly accessible, creating new openings for commercial fishing, shipping lanes, energy development, and forcing Arctic states to clearly map out their sovereignty claims. Many of these claims are relatively new, and many are sharply contested. Just looking at a map of the Arctic Ocean, it's fairly easy to understand why. There are several pinch points where sovereign claims come into close contact. The Bering Strait, separating Russia and the United States, is less than 30 miles across in some areas. While there's currently not much traffic flowing through that region, the volume of traffic is increasing every year, and with it, risks of accidents, miscommunications, misunderstandings, and so on. Further, the Bering Strait is and will increasingly be a major choke point for Russian oil and gas exports, increasing the need for search and rescue facilities, Coast Guard protections, and so on. The Northwest Passage is claimed by Canada as an archipelago, a claim that would give Canada sovereign control and exclusive jurisdiction through the passage. But other countries, including the United States, reject Canada's claim and assert that the passage is an international waterway connecting two oceans, which means it would be governed by the law of the sea and must be open to navigation and freedom of movement. A similar tension plays out in the Northeast Passage between Russia and the rest of the world on its claims. And then there are numerous disputed territorial claims, including the dispute over Hans Island, which is claimed by both Canada and Denmark. There's also the competing claims over the Lomonosov Ridge, which is claimed by Canada, Denmark, and Russia, each asserting that the ridge extends into their own continental shelf, and thus extends their legal claim to resources out as part of that exclusive economic zone. For its part, the United States maintains that the ridge is an oceanic ridge and thus cannot extend any country's continental shelf, effectively rejecting the claims of all three states. There's also the Beaufort Sea, and that includes an area of about 8,000 square miles that's claimed both by the United States and Canada. The area is believed to hold significant oil reserves, and the two countries have not been able to resolve differences over interpretation of national boundaries in the area. The U.S.-Canadian dispute over parts of the Beaufort Sea highlight a broader tension emerging in the Arctic over resource extraction. Retreating sea ice is opening vast new territories and regions of the Arctic for exploration and potentially for the extraction of new resources. While an international agreement currently prohibits commercial fishing by trawlers in the Arctic until 2035, that agreement will likely come under increasing pressure and competition over fisheries was likely to intensify, particularly as global fish stocks elsewhere in the world are exhausted and warming oceans drive remaining fish stocks in search of cooler temperatures into the Arctic and Antarctic waters. The race to secure new oil and gas fields in the Arctic has already begun, though it's still a bit of a mystery exactly how much oil and gas is there. A 2008 study by the U.S. Geological Survey estimated that as much as 30% of the world's natural gas reserves and about 13% of the world's oil reserves were located in the Arctic, representing potentially hundreds of billions of dollars worth of resources. And finally, most geologists also believe that the Arctic is home to vast reserves of other minerals, including coal, iron, zinc, lead, nickel, and numerous precious metals and gemstones. While accessing both the oil and gas as well as the mineral resources of the Arctic is currently very expensive, the retreating sea ice will likely reduce the cost of accessing those resources in the future, increasing pressure on countries to assert control over resource extraction. And the stakes are huge. Already an estimated 20% of Russia's gross domestic product comes from the Arctic region, mostly from oil and gas extraction. We should anticipate that that figure will increase as new resources become increasingly accessible. But of course, continued extraction of these resources, particularly of the Arctic's oil and gas, creates a vicious circle, further exacerbating greenhouse gas emissions and intensifying the impact of climate change in the Arctic. Retreating sea ice will also open new shipping lanes across the Arctic. Indeed, the discovery of a sea lane connecting the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans, a Northwest Passage, has been the goal of naval expeditions for hundreds of years. Such a sea lane could potentially cut shipping times between Europe and China, for example, by up to 2 weeks, depending upon the ice conditions. Currently, two sea lanes are of particular interest. The first is the Northeast Passage that transits along the northern coast of Russia and Norway to connect the Pacific Ocean with the North Atlantic. This route is largely subject to Russian control. The vast majority of shipping through the region is comprised of large oil and natural gas tankers. Though the route is increasingly free of ice, Russia continues to maintain a large fleet of icebreakers to ensure that the route remains open. If the ice continues to melt, the route could remain open year-round. Such access would reduce the distance traveled from Japan, Korea, and China to Europe by about one-third. The second passage of interest is the Northwest Passage. This route connects the Atlantic and Pacific by traversing the North American waterways, largely through areas claimed by Canada. The melting of sea ice in the Northwest Passage has been slower than that in the Northeast Passage, and Canada and the United States possess many fewer icebreakers than Russia, further limiting the commercial viability of this route. Nevertheless, it's expected that the route will increasingly be opened as a result of global climate change. A third route is also worth mentioning briefly, although it's likely further out than the other two, and this is the Transpolar Sea Route. It avoids territorial waters of all of the countries involved by transiting across the Arctic Ocean itself. While this route is not commercially viable due to sea ice, it's expected that the route will become a predominant Arctic shipping lane by 2030. The Chinese icebreaker Snow Dragon was the first ship to cross the Transpolar Sea Route, doing so in 2008. In the short to medium term, icebreaker capacity has become a focal point for Arctic tensions, and Russia has a long history and a strong lead in this area. The Russian government currently has the world's largest fleet of icebreakers, including 6 heavy nuclear-powered icebreakers with another 3 on order. Such icebreakers are capable of operating in the Arctic year-round. Russia also has a fleet of approximately 20 medium icebreakers. The United States, by contrast, has just one heavy icebreaker, the Polar Star, and that ship is nearing the end of its life cycle. It also has one medium icebreaker. While the United States is much stronger in other aspects of Arctic operations, including the use of submarines and military overflights, the lack of icebreakers limits the U.S. surface vessel presence in the Arctic. The United States is currently building a new heavy icebreaker, but that ship is not scheduled for delivery until sometime after 2024. And interestingly, China has also become increasingly involved. Indeed, as just noted, the Chinese icebreaker Snow Dragon, a medium icebreaker, was the first ship to pass through the Transarctic Sea Route. China has 2 medium icebreakers, and the Chinese government is investing extensively in new icebreaking ships and technology in anticipation of the route opening over longer and longer periods of time as the Arctic warms. From the perspective of the Chinese government, a transarctic sea route would reduce its dependence on other waterways, including the Straits of Malacca and the Panama and Suez canals. China thus views the Arctic competition as a central part of its military and economic strategy for the 21st century, despite the fact that it itself is not an Arctic nation. To be clear, the re-emerging geostrategic competition taking place in the Arctic is largely a function of climate change. Retreating sea ice, melting permafrost, and rising ocean temperatures are all currently underway, and many of these trends are taking place far more rapidly in the Arctic than elsewhere in the world. As I mentioned previously, there's also a strange feedback loop at play. Climate change is making Arctic resources, including oil, gas, coal, and timber, more readily accessible via new sea lanes caused by melting sea ice and at lower prices. But extracting and consuming these resources exacerbates climate change, which in turn opens new resources for exploitation and so on. Melting permafrost further releases large amounts of methane, a powerful greenhouse gas. Action by the Arctic Council to address climate change has been blocked primarily by the United States. While the U.S. military is taking steps to plan for climate change, the U.S. political structure has been unwilling to recognize climate change as a real threat that needs to be addressed and mitigated. As a consequence, U.S. relations with historical allies like Norway, Denmark, Iceland, and Canada have deteriorated. And U.S. inaction has also created an avenue for China to claim a mantle of leadership in this area, emphasizing its solar energy programs while it continues to seek access to and control over fossil fuels. Indigenous communities in the Arctic have also suffered as climate change threatens their way of life, particularly their traditional food sources. Coastal erosion also threatens seaside villages. The Yupik village of Nutok in Alaska has been forced to abandon their traditional location and relocate to a new site some 9 miles away as a result of melting permafrost and rising tides. Other sites occupied by Yupik for thousands of years are being swept into the sea, and as this happens, the cultural legacy of the tribe is also disappearing. The move has been chronicled by numerous journalists and news outlets. The cost of relocation has been extensive, more than $100 million in total so far, and this is likely just the first wave of climate refugees as we move into the future. And so, in many ways, the Arctic is a portal into the future of a changing world. That's all the time we have in this video. Leave your thoughts in the comments section below, and thanks for watching, everyone. Have a good day. Bye.